I started trapping when I was about 10 years old, protecting my chickens and show poultry. And I guess I've been at it about 32 years.
Over those 32 years, trapping has been part of Fred's livelihood. During that time, trapping laws and practices have gone through many changes, with trappers themselves suggesting and adopting many of them.
Trapping is highly regulated through the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department, and the New Hampshire Trappers Association working very close with New Hampshire Fish and Game to make the right choices.
Today, trappers in New Hampshire are required to have a trapping license and proof that they've completed a trapper education course or have previously held a trapping license.
So this is a permit to trap. Now, if you're going to use snares, in addition to this permit to trap...
During these courses, students learn trapping practices and regulations.
And you make your hole first and foremost.
They also pick up tips from seasoned trappers.
I tend to set my traps back some. I don't
trapping is as much a management tool as a way of life. With New Hampshire's continued growth and development, conflicts between wildlife and people are on the increase. It's all about carrying capacity.
The carrying capacity is about the number of animals that a habitat can support or a given area can support.
To keep wildlife at healthy levels, wildlife managers rely on regulated trapping. Studies have shown, with state agency oversight, regulated trapping doesn't cause species to become endangered.
In today's day and age, when we have really good regulations on trapping, there tend not to be any real negative consequences for the overall population. Basically, we're able to keep our numbers of fur bearers at a level where they're not impacting the populations of other species too much. We're basically able to keep the fur bearers at a population level that's neither too high nor too low. So trapping is really the number one tool that we have to manage those populations.
Industrial areas, private residents, and cities also rely on trapping to help control property damage and protect public health.
We've lost about an acre of our lawn, as you can see around me here. We never had this particular problem before because we pretty much always kept them in check, but because we felt that we could just live with them and leave them alone, in 1 year's time, they managed to take away a lot of our lawn, plus affect our other neighbors. So therefore, we had to go back to a management type control to remove the beavers and just scale it down to maybe one or two.
One of the big concerns I have about the beaver is a lot of our cornfields run along the river, and there are a number of the beaver in the river, and on one field, I could count about seven or eight places where they'd come up from the river. It takes out the vegetation, and I'm worried about erosion.
We have some public health issues with our beaver population.
Aquatic mammals, like beaver, carry Giardia and Cryptosporidium, which are harmful to humans. These organisms are released into the water through beaver droppings.
We have kind of a multi-phased approach to our beaver management program. Most of the treatment facility within our 4,000-foot sanitation radius, we try to have a zero tolerance for beaver within that area. Out on the watershed itself, we attempt to manage the beaver population to keep them down a little bit so we don't have problems with beaver in streams, going under roads, in those kinds of areas.
As more and more people escape city life for rural and suburban areas, the number of negative human-wildlife encounters increase.
There's still a place for trapping, maybe more of a need for trapping than there's ever been, because we've had more of an impact on natural communities. Fragmentation and habitat division, reduction, and loss is more and more of an issue.
Mike Morrison is a teacher at Monadnock Regional High School in Swansea, New Hampshire. He's also an avid trapper. Today, he's with two of his students that are interested in learning more about trapping.
Trapping is a way of actively being a participant in these grand cycles that are going on around us, as opposed to being passive consumers.
Part of that involvement is the use of best management practices, or BMPs. It's the largest research project undertaken in the U.S. by state fish and wildlife agencies and trappers themselves. Guidelines are being developed to improve the welfare of captured animals, develop more humane trapping methods and equipment, and teach responsible behaviors.
Best management practices are an ongoing testing process that evaluates different kinds of traps, different kinds of sets, different procedures to make sure that this is done as humanely as possible. As trappers, we want to continue to be improving all the time.
Wildlife biologists use regulated trapping to benefit people and wildlife species like river otter. Through trapping and relocation, otter have been restored to other states where they had disappeared. Endangered species have benefited too. The piping plover, found on New Hampshire's seacoast, have a better chance of hatching their eggs because trappers control the local skunk population.
As we lose more and more habitat, we become responsible for the critters that are out there. We have to make sure that they're going to be viable over the long term. So if one of the ways that we can protect those species of conservation concern is by trapping, then that's a good thing, that we can make sure that we have a balanced ecosystem. We have some of our less common species along with some of the more common species.
The challenge for wildlife biologists will be to continue to balance the needs of people and wildlife with the tools they have available.